Sawa sawa. Before you take your seats, I need you to ask your neighbor to find an adjective, rather a word that can describe them in one sentence. Ask your neighbor a word that can describe them. Ask them. Engage with your neighbor and tell them to tell you a word that can describe them. Just one word. Amen. Lord, we thank you this morning. As we sit to listen to your word, we pray that your word will find a fertile place in our hearts and in our lives. We pray for strength, for courage, for grace, even to put this word into practice. So we pray that, Lord, you may bless this time and that your name will be glorified. It is in Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said, amen. You may have your seats. It's good to see you this morning. My name is Fred Imbayi, and I'm humbled this morning to bring the word of God to us. Thank you so much, Pastor Brian. Thank you, Pastor Benjamin, and the whole pastoral team for this opportunity. Thank you, Dan, for such a wonderful job you're doing with Relentless, and all the young people serving with Relentless. May God bless you so much. I am not married, but I am straight. Thank God for that. Let's give God a good round of applause. Very soon I'll be getting married. My wife-to-be is right here. So before the day, you are all invited. Amen. And the word for us today, this morning, I would like to share about characteristics of a Christian. And like Dan has shared with us, the aim of this sermon is to encourage us to ignite our passion for Christ once again. Amen. Somebody is here whose passion for Christ is dying. The aim of this sermon is to challenge you and to put you to a place where you start thinking again about Christ. Amen. And I'd like to start by sharing a story about an emperor in Thailand. This guy was growing old, and soon he would die, and he needed someone to replace him. And normally what would happen is he would pick his son or a family member or somebody in the family to replace him. But this time around, he decided that he's going to do something different. So he called one of his assistants and sent him to the streets and told him to go and get him about 20 boys, young boys, age of 12. So the assistant went and got these boys, 20 of them. And what the emperor did is he gave them seeds, mbegu. And he told them to go and plant the seeds, to water them, to take care of them, and bring the plant 1 year down the line. And from those plants, he would decide who would be the next emperor. And so the boys went home, and they started planting the seeds, watering the seeds. And there was a particular young man called Ling. So his seed did not grow. It was dead. So he kept on watering, checking on it every day, but nothing was happening. Months passed, days passed, but nothing was happening. So he got worried and asked the mom, "I don't think I'll make it to be an emperor because my seed is doing nothing. I can hear my friend's seeds growing. Already their friends are already boosting in the streets and saying that their seeds are growing and becoming big, and Ling's seed was doing nothing." So he went to the mom and told the mom, "What should I do?" And the mom said, "It is okay, just continue. After a year, just take the pot with the seed back to the emperor." 1 year later, they went back to the emperor. He called them, and it was time to pick the emperor and to decide who would replace him. And the seeds, the other boys, the seeds had grown. The big trees had become excellent trees, and they were happy. And each one of them was excited that I would be the next emperor. And Ling was there, very ashamed. In fact, standing back because he was very embarrassed. Everyone had a plant except him. And the emperor looked around and he congratulated all of them for the work they have done. And he said, "It is now time for me to choose the emperor. I think I know who it is." He called Ling to the front and said, "Ling, you're going to be the emperor." And everyone was why this guy be the emperor? He has nothing. This is what the emperor told him. He gave them dead seeds. All the seeds, all of them were dead. They were boiled seeds, so they could not germinate. So what these other boys did, they went and found other seeds that were not given by the emperor. So they lied. They brought seeds that the emperor did not give them. And so the emperor did what? Chose Ling because he was very honest. He used that as a characteristic to choose the next emperor. His honesty. And we love characteristics, right? They help us choose products. They help us choose cars we drive. They help us in making decisions about food, about houses, about schools, and even about the kind of people we will get married to. We're looking at certain features and characteristics, just like the emperor was looking for. Honesty as a characteristic to choose an emperor. And from the dictionary, a characteristic is simply a feature, an attribute, or a habit that belongs to a person, a place, or a thing, and it helps us in identifying these things. I repeat, it is a feature, an attribute, or a habit that belongs to something, to someone, or to a place, and these things help us in identifying these things. For example, when you go to the supermarket, you clearly know blue band is yellow, sindio? Eric say hallelujah, yellow, yellow. Ukipata blue band black, you'll be worried, sindio? Because in your mind, the characteristic for blue band is color, yellow. And these things are good. We love them. Talking about Christianity, we have characteristics that should define us, that when people see these things, they will clearly say, this is a Christian. Amen. Now, in the recent days, of course, you've had fake things, fake blue band, fake fish, fake, everything is now fake. Even fake skumawiki. Kuna skumawiki ya plastic, by the way. Nani amekula? Fake, very fake. And they're fake because they do not match the originals. Sindio? By the way, if you go to the bank, those tellers, they're only trained to identify original notes, not fake. So when they lift up the notes to look at that color, and they're only checking to see if that is an original note. Amen. We live in a world of labels, and everything defines people and things. Even for us Christians, we have things that should define us, characteristics that people can easily identify with and say, when you see this, this is a Christian. Now Jesus says in Matthew 7 verse 18 to 21, a healthy tree cannot bear bad fruit, nor can a diseased tree bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Thus you will recognize them by their fruits. Amen. By their fruits you will be able to say whether it is a good tree or a bad tree. Talking about Christianity. And the first instance people are called Christians is a place called Antioch. Now Jesus had just ascended back to heaven, and the disciples were under so much persecution and trials and things and suffering. And they came to a place called Antioch. And this place was a place of Jews and Gentiles. And they could not mix. It was so bad that these people could not even talk to each other. It was rough. Now, Christians came to this place, the disciples. And their habit, their way of living was so different that a name was to be found to categorize them, to call them. Because clearly it was about Jews and Gentiles. Now there is another group of people that we don't know the name of. And now they had to find a name to call them because their character was different. How they talked to people was different. How they lived was different. And that's how the name Christianity came to be. And they were called Christians because their behavior, their activity, their speech were like that of Jesus Christ. When people looked at them, they said, these people talk like Jesus. They speak like Jesus. They live like Jesus. Their behavior is that of Jesus. And so they call them Christians. Why? Because of how they lived their lives. There are some things, characteristics, that identified them, that showed that these people are very different. In our day's world, we have been labeled all sorts of things. But we need to have those things that God tells us, define us, those things that would define us as Christians. And I want to share with us today five characteristics of a Christian. Five characteristics of a Christian. There could be so many, but I just narrowed down to five. And like I said, remember, if you're here and your passion for Christ is dying, I hope by the end of this sermon that through these five characteristics, you'll get to a place where you would want to live for Christ. Your passion for Christ will be ignited. Amen. Let me start with the first one. The number one characteristic of a Christian. Number one is that they are visible. A Christian is visible. A Christian is visible. In today's world, everyone wants to identify themselves, and they're very bold. Homosexuals will come out and say, hey, I am gay, I am homosexual. Very funny things, and people will stand up and defend their identity. They are very courageous, they are very bold. But in that list of bold people, we have failed. Christians have hidden their identity. They are cowards. Let me use that word, if you allow me. We are cowards, rather. When everyone says they are gay and they are all these things, we cannot say we are Christians. We are scared of people knowing who we really are. The verse we just read this morning, Jesus tells the crowd listening to them that you're the light and salt of the earth. And he says, we do not light lamps and hide them under the table. And rather, he says, a city set on a hill cannot be hidden. Why are we scared as Christians to hide, to show our identity? Why do we lock ourselves in the room when everyone is out there saying who they are? In fact, why do we even have parental control for our guidance for TV shows? It's because the world is so bold of who they are, and that's why we have to protect our children from seeing those funny things on TV, because they're very bold. They don't hide those sex scenes that we see. They don't hide drugs. They don't hide violence. But we have hidden our identity as Christians. And Jesus says, you are the light of the earth in a dark world. You are the salt of the earth that has lost its flavor. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. And it's like we have hidden our identity. We have people here ashamed to say they are Christians at work. In your workplace, nobody knows you're a Christian. Young people whose neighbors and relatives do not know that you're a Christian. We have students who are ashamed to share their faith before their peers. Why? Watachekelewa. Sindio? And at times people look at us on Sundays leaving for church, but they only assume these people are going to work. Only their shift is at 10 in the morning, because they don't know we're going to church. We are ashamed to say we are Christians. Our church mission is to be, vision rather, is to be a vibrant and a passionate church that is changing the world for Christ. But we cannot change the world for Christ if we are cowards, if we are ashamed of who we are. We cannot. Amen. A Christian is different. Your path is very different, not like everyone else. When everyone else is bowing down, a Christian should be standing tall. You need to be seen as a Christian. Titus chapter 2, 11 to 12 says, for the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. We need to stand and say we are Christians. So this morning, if you're listening to me and you're a Christian, you need to go out there and be visible. People need to see you. People need to see you that you are a Christian. Corruption is very visible. Violence is very visible. But people need to see that there's a Christian wherever you are. Amen. So I charge you to be whether you are at home, in your workplaces, in wherever you are, you need to be visible. You need to be a Christian. Just like this church of Antioch, they were visible, they were so distinct that people said, these people are different. So go home and be visible, be a Christian. Amen. Number two, another characteristic of a Christian is that this person loves Christ and they are committed to following him. They love Christ and they are committed to following Christ. And by the way, one of the marks of showing that you really love Christ, according to John chapter 14, verse 15, Jesus says, if you love me, keep my commandments. Keep my commandments. That is one, the surest way to show that you love Jesus, you love God, is by keeping his commandments. That is the only sign you can show that you love God. And we know these commandments. Commandments about how we should relate with other people, how we should relate with everyone around us, how we should deal with money, how we should relate with God. We know all these commandments. And we should keep them. By the way, not only keeping them, but you should be happy and delighted in keeping them. We should not look at these commandments as a burden, as something that is heavy on us, that, God, again, you want me to do this. No. It should be a delight. It should be a joy. Psalm chapter 1, David says that blessed is a man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked. He continues to say that, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. His delight. You are happy. You're joyful in keeping God's commands. You're happy, excited about doing them. Like we said, number two, that they love Christ. Not only loving him, but they are committed to following Christ. They are committed. They are committed to following Christ. The meaning of a disciple is a follower. A follower of Jesus. You're following him. You're following his ideas. Following his suggestions. Whatever he wants for you, you're following. I have a question for you this morning. If you are honest about yourself, would you say you are a committed Christian, following after Christ, looking and seeking after him? Would you say, I seek him? And how do we follow Christ? Like I said, one, by keeping his commands. Number two, by doing those things that will bring us closer to him. Bible study groups, church. I know it's very cold, and by the way, clap for yourselves, you made it to church this morning. Amen. You're a good follower of Christ. I have just measured the temperature today, and it is -3. And you have come to church. Let's appreciate the Lord. He's good. Amen. We should be hungry for God. Commitment is, whether it rains or not, I will come to church. Commitment is, whether I feel like praying or not, I will pray. Following Christ means, whether that word makes sense to me or not, I will wake up in the morning and study the Bible. Amen. We've been calling out you guys to join life groups. I almost said discipleship groups. Please. You're not doing that so that we have numbers. We're doing that so that you do what? You grow and become a better Christian. We are not asking you to join a life group so that we have activity happening here on Sunday. No. It is for your good, so that you have a closer relationship with Christ. So number two, a disciple of Jesus, a Christian, is somebody who loves Christ and is committed to following Christ, no matter what, you are there with him. Number three, a Christian lives with an eternal perspective. Eternal perspective. Death is something that we need to come to terms with, that one day I will die. It may not be now. No matter how I postpone death, one day it will catch up with us. We don't live forever. Amen. We will not live forever. Standing here today, I know that someday people will come and sing around my grave and say how I was this and that. But then I will have gone. And one reality I will face is that I will account my life God. I will go and share with God and tell him how I lived my life. The mistakes that I made, the choices that I made, I will talk to him. Do you ever think about heaven? Do you think about heaven? Do you think of the thought? What will it look like? Somebody sang a song and says, I can only imagine. I don't know. What is his name? Hey, Masimi, I can only imagine when I go to heaven, what it will look like? Surrounded by God and his angels, what will it be? If you're here and you're a Christian, you need to think about eternity. Philippians 3, verse 13 to 15, Paul says, brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it. But one thing I do, forgetting what is behind me and straining forward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenwards in Christ Jesus. Do you think about heaven? Colossians chapter 3, verse 1 and 2. If then you have been raised with Jesus, seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Verse 2 says, set your mind on things above, not on things on the earth. Truth is, you will die. Amen. Yes, I know you don't like this idea of death thing, but just be okay with it. You will die. Amen. Yes. And you will go and face God. And you will account for your life. How is your heaven account? How does your heavenly account look like? As you work hard here on earth, as you amass wealth here on earth, as you have fame here on earth, as you are called these big names here on earth, what name do you have in heaven? What wealth do you have in heaven? Jesus says in Matthew chapter 6 that lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where moth and rust do not eat. It's okay to work. It's okay to have all these things. But how is your heaven? How is your heaven? How does it look like? Amen. Number one, like I said, characteristics of a Christian, they are visible. Number two, we've said they love Christ and they're committed to following him. Number three, they live with an eternal perspective. They are thinking about heaven. One day they will face God. And the question for you today is, if God would take you this morning, are you ready? Are you ready to, you know, to face him? If he would decide that I'm taking you this morning, are you ready? Another characteristic of a Christian, number four, is that they make other disciples. A Christian makes other disciples. There's a verse in Matthew 28. Jesus tells the disciples that all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. And he commissions them. He tells them to go and make disciples of all nations. And this instruction, church, is not given to pastors only. This instruction is not given to church leaders only, to ushers, to the people serving in church only. No. This instruction is for every Christian to go and make disciples. Are you making any disciple? Are you even telling someone about your faith? Have you ever invited someone to church? You know, it doesn't begin by very complicated theological study. No. It begins by just inviting someone to church. Hey, let's go to church. Then slowly by slowly. By the way, do you have a Bible? 1, 2, 3. You share these things with them. That is one way of making a disciple. Are you making a disciple? Even in your conduct. Paul tells Timothy that you should not allow anyone to despise you because you're young, but you should be an example to the believers in what? In word, in conduct, in faith, and in purity. They should be looking at you and they should be saying, like we've read in the verse, Matthew chapter 5, let men see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. Are you making any disciples? Just by the way you live. Are you inviting anyone to church? Are you talking about your faith with people? A Christian shares their faith. Amen. So go home and talk to someone about Jesus. invite them to church. When you go to Bible study, call them, go with them. Do it at home with your families. Make a disciple. We have parents here. I don't know what picture you have for your children. If you ask me, I am not a parent at the moment, but I will be a parent if God allows, and yes, God will allow. I would want them to be a follower of Christ. And that does not happen by osmosis or by diffusion. It does not happen by Bluetooth. Sindio, I have to be very intentional about sharing my faith with my children and telling them, hey, this is the way it should be. You know, parents, you want your children to be good children, right? But, you know, you have to show them. You have to make disciples out of them. Amen. They make disciples. Are you making any disciples? That is a question I have for you this morning. Number five. Christians remain strong in the face of trials and hard times. They remain strong. You cannot imagine what the disciples, as he brought the gospel to us, went through. They were killed. They were tortured. They were persecuted. All manner of sorts of things were done to them. But they remained firm and strong. And we can agree that we go through hard times. Hard times financially. Hard times emotionally. We go through all sorts of challenges and hard times that come to our lives. That is not the time for us to quit and say Christianity does not work. It is not time for us to blame God and say, where were you when this was happening? It is not time for us to say, this faith thing does not work. Christians remain strong. I was thinking of how I would share this with us. And Elvis, I want you to play that song. I just want you to listen to this song for a second.
Of it all, when you feel so undeserving, don't be afraid, don't be ashamed. I am right here, call on my name. I'm in the midst of it all. Please don't worry, I'm in the midst of it all.
You can go and listen to that song at home. But what this song is simply saying is that I am in the midst of it all. When your life is hurting, when you're going through hard times, who is in the midst of this all? God is there with you. Our attitude should be what James says, that we should count it all joy. When you go through trials and tribulations, count it all joy. Isaiah tells us that, fear not, do not be dismayed, for I am with you. God is there with you. When you don't have rent, when you are scared about life, when everything is not working, God is there with you. He's in the midst of it all. That should be your attitude as a Christian. And that should encourage you to remain strong and firm. Maybe I'm talking to somebody this morning who is hurting, who is in the midst of a rock and a hard place, who is going through a difficult time. I don't know how, but I want to encourage you this morning not to give up. Because God is right there with you. He's there with you. Amen. So don't abandon the faith. Don't walk. Don't quit on God. He's with you. That is one characteristic of a Christian. They don't give up. They don't blame God. They don't say, history I work. They don't say, I have prayed for the X number of years you prayed for and it is not working. They don't say, don't quit. Remain strong. Jesus went through a tougher time, one that we cannot even imagine. And he says, no servant is greater than the master. You are the servants, he is the master. If the master went through a hard time, you, his servants, are not greater than him. And he says, when? Not if that hard times come. No, it is when they come. And I want to tell you this morning, hard times will come. You will lose a job. You will... Bad things will happen. Things may not always go as planned. But don't quit on God. Don't quit. He's there with you. He understands you. Amen. And as you listen to me, maybe you're thinking, these things are too complicated. They are hard. How can someone be these things? Are they hard? Yes, they are hard. But I have good news for you this morning. God is not calling you to be perfect. Amen. As we listen to these characteristics, God is not asking you to be perfect. God is just asking that somebody here say, I want to try to be these things. I want to try to be visible. I want to try to be, you know, the things that we've talked about. God is not asking you to be perfect. No. He's just asking you, are you willing to try to be this kind of a person that you're talking today? And he will give you strength. He will enable you. He will give you the things that you need. Philippians tells us that it is God who causes us to will and to do. Even the good thing you're doing, it is God allowing you to do those good things. So I want to pray with people here this morning. And maybe you're here, you're just new in the faith. You have no idea what you should do. I want to encourage you that these characteristics that we've shared this morning, it is God who will help you. Amen. That is how you should look like. As you listen to me, don't think, I am so bad. I'm far from it. Like I said, the aim is not to show you how guilty you are or how messed up you are or how far from it you are. No. The aim is to show you what you can be in Christ. If you only try, if you only allow yourself to be a place where he can use you to be visible. He can use you to follow him. Amen. So you're new in the faith. That is what you should look like. You have an idea now. And God will help you. I'm talking to somebody here this morning who has not received Christ as their Lord and Savior. And my prayer is that you will receive Christ and be this kind of person we are talking today. I'm talking to someone this morning who is saved, yes, who has been saved for many years, but their passion for Christ, they're no longer doing these things. They are on a cruise mode, you know. They have forgotten about sharing their faith. They have stopped being visible. They are now just there, and their faith is dying. I want to encourage you to charge yourself up and rise up and start serving and living for God again and be this kind of person we are talking this morning. Jesus, through John, in the book of Revelation, he writes to the seven churches. And one of the churches is the church of Ephesus. And he tells him that I know your good works. I know these things you've done. But I have this one thing against you. You have lost your first love. And somebody is here, a Christian, serving God. Yes, but you have lost your first love. My prayer is that you will ignite your passion. You will revive your fire for Christ. I'm talking to somebody who is saved, yes, who is working for Christ, doing all these things, who is being visible, who is doing all these things that we are saying. My encouragement to you this morning is that you continue, that you should not give up. But remember, like Paul said, we have not reached, we have not achieved. And Paul says, I strive. I challenge myself to move on and on and on. Amen. So I want to invite the worship team as we go to a time of prayer. And first, I want to pray for this person who is here, who is not born again. Somebody who has not experienced this love that you're talking about. If you're there, I would like to invite you to come and make the Lord Jesus your Savior. If you're there, I want us to bow our heads at this moment. There's this song in Kiswahili that says, Kama si wewe ningekuwa wapi, mimi. If you're there and you have not received Christ as your Lord and Savior, this is for you. I want you to come today to the best decision you can ever make for your life. You're there and you have not received Christ. I would like you to raise up your hand and we will pray together. You have not received Christ. He is there stretching his arms to you, loving you. He's calling out to you this morning. If you're there and you have not received Jesus as your Lord and Savior, very boldly raise up your hand and we will pray with you. Anybody? Anybody saying, I have not received Christ? I want to pray with you this morning. I want to pray with someone this morning who, evaluating your life, you can clearly see that, hey, I am not really being a Christian. I am a bit far off. I know I can do better. I know I can be a better Christian. I want to pray with you. If you're there and you're saying, I want to be a better Christian. I want to be more visible. I want to make other disciples. I want to remain strong. I want to do all these things we have shared today. I want you to come to the front and pray for yourself. If you're saying, I want to be a better Christian. Boldly, without fear, without kogopa mtu, come and pray for yourself. I want to invite you to the front. This is for you. Please come and recommit and ask God to help you become a better Christian. Are you there? And you can clearly hear the voice of God telling you that you can do better. If you're there, I'm asking you to come. We'll pray together. He's not asking you to be perfect. He just wants you to come and be used of him. Tell him that you're weak, that you cannot do it alone, and ask him to enable you to be this kind of person we are describing today. Maybe you are ashamed. Maybe you are scared. Maybe you think it is too much. Pray for yourself this morning.
Come and see your way.
this morning. We thank you for saving us, oh God. We thank you for dying on the cross for our sins and choosing a different path for our lives, oh God. And Father, we fall short many times. We do not live our lives the way we ought to live. And we ask for forgiveness, Lord. And Father, we realize that it is hard at times. It is difficult. And this morning, Lord, we are praying for your strength. Lord, we are praying for your grace. We are praying for your wisdom to help us to live this life that we are talking about in a manner that is worthy of the calling that we have received. We thank you, Jesus. We pray that, Father, you will help us to be bold and visible, oh God. Lord, we are praying that you may help us to be committed Christians who love you and who follow you. Father, in the midst of trials and hard times, Lord, we pray that you may help us to remain firm and strong. Lord, I pray that with the little lives that we live, we pray that you may help us to be of influence to other people and to make disciples, oh God. We thank you, oh God. We thank you for being associated with you. We thank you for choosing a different lifestyle for us. And Father, help us. Help us to live this kind of life. We thank you, oh God. And we bless you. It is in Jesus' name we pray. And everybody say it. Amen. Why don't you give God a good round of applause?